about that incident, Father Michael takes his sons to come close and away from the building and took the entrance to his mother to prepare. Please use this time to take your friends out and ensure that they are all for our time of no. Thank you.
Everyone excited? recent Pope of the Roman Catholic Church and today's ceremony. No, it's not which one of these is not like the other. The question is, what do these things have in common, you may ask? The answer is, they all happen on April 24th. Matchmaker, matchmaker, make us a match. Find us a wine, catch us a catch. So then we went on about the business of writing the advertisement. Oh, did we struggle on that? Oh, my word. We thought and we thought, and it has to be fitting to go in the Chronicle of Higher Education and on social media. So after thinking about it for a long time and struggling, because our aunt was so alone, we decided we could have made it very simple. normally didn't have a big party over, shall we say. So consider this your big party. And we were worried about the family because, you know, if we think Dr. Esberg is the one, and she thinks this is the place, but if the family thinks this is not one, well, it took us too long to figure out that we had to do pretty much at all. Because we had trouble dragging around the crane complex to keep up with all the meetings we had scheduled. So we didn't like us too, like Katie and Chumcha. So, the committee recommends candidates to the College Council. The College Council then recommends candidates to the Chancellor. The Chancellor interviews and recommends a single candidate to the SUNY Board of Trustees. The Chancellor then gives her blessing. Thank you, Chancellor Linford. Some leaders are born women. We have one of those right here today.
president of the Student Government Foundation, I would like to take this time to welcome you all to present the inauguration of Dr. Kristen D. Ellsworth. And I would like to use our time to create excitement and anticipation, to look forward to the possibilities that the future may bring, the heights that we have yet reached. As students know, it is sometimes assumed that the capacity of such an event can be possible. We may fail to recognize the shift in paradigm that presidential inauguration can mean for an institution. I am deeply pleased to say that this is not true of Moscow. The students have embraced the change that this year has brought, and I see no indication of that stopping anytime soon. Our college is a place of academic learning and personal growth. The students are the lifeblood of the institution, just as much as the building ground is our growth. The betterment of the student experience must be at the foreground of the student agenda. As we enter our third century here at Potsdam, the student body is firmly entrenched in its dedication to this mission. In the past year, I have seen little to suggest that Dr. Esterberg is of a different mindset. As I conclude my studies at Potsdam this year, I will be denied the joy of seeing firsthand the continued collaboration between students and administration to further enhance the Potsdam experience. I am extremely confident that the Potsdam High League of 2015 will be surpassed by the Potsdam High Return Student for alumni events, personal visits to see faculty and friends, and the eventual moving day for my first class. I am confident in this because of the commitment of the student body and the leadership of my president. In closing, I wish to again welcome all of you in attendance to our beloved Potsdam. May we take part in celebrating Potsdam's future, a future of collaboration, cooperation, and excellence, under the stewardship of Dr. Kristen D. Ellsworth. Thank you.
Have 100
parents of alumni and friends of Michael Lakeville. And she's enthusiastically supported the work of the fundraising team. And, most importantly, she has already given to the campaign. Okay. So, I'm sure
I don't want to know.
bring many good things to our community. It brings students, energy, vitality, and basically it's our way to make it right to the street. It brings the fact that it's set up with the ready talent, the good friendship to our community. And I think it does not hurt the friendship. It's a way of life, and it also brings a sizable payroll into the door, and perhaps an increasing payroll in the near future, looking at state representatives. And now we can add something else to that list of good things, and that is Judge Christopher and her family. I've already had an opportunity to work with her, and I've gotten to know that not only will she be a terrific advocate for City Plastic, but she will also be a strong advocate for the Village of Plastic and the community of Clark. And so, in my role as mayor, it gives me great pleasure to give the official welcome to the Village of Plastic to President Estenberg and her family. Welcome, President Estenberg. It's great to have you here. Supervisor of the town of Sam, also an emeritus faculty of City Camp, and a former distinguished award winner from the Chancellor Awards. And we discovered today in the dressing room that the medal weighs more than the reason. Where we may go emerged from the
reality. One detail has gotten down hard to get to what it includes in the number. And rain will not be lost in memory. What weight is sprinkled with dirt, salt, goat foot, or remainders, streets and joint and jazz of the top floor. That path in the slipping mist, and it was taken in the same way as feet. I go down to the front porch, battling me once again. It's pretty to be a full recovery. Look outside. Look outside and begin and out again. Pull yourself together. Begin and out before you forget the time. Stay good and begin with your words. Out. Tonight you carry your sight like a crap of sliding cheese. Enjoy all the rain that you've got. Your breathing will take your place. Will tell you who you are. Set your memories on fire. Count the steps by your childhood. Years and years that lie ahead like a refreshing, surreal horizon.
Thank you.
courtship of the new president. We had the proposal, we had the acceptance, and today we have the ceremony that makes it officially official. A celebration such as this one that we share today helps mark a new chapter not only for Sidney Crosby and the institution, but for all of us here who play an important role in the lives of our three communities. As we mark this transition into the college of history, we think about the work of God. Almost 200 years, and our strong foundation of excellence in education. And by the way, I want your calendar because you're all invited next year to celebrate the bicentennial of Sidney Crosby, the oldest institution in all of the city, right, Stephen?
Thank you.
pre-programmed and integration of the experience activity. We are also a system with an attitude. We have a value proposition. Our elected officials have heard it many times over. In 2010, we crafted a strategic plan for State University of New York, which we aptly, in my view, call the power of cities, that we could at the same time lift the economic future of the city and also enhance the quality of life of every citizen in this state. And we have worked very hard over the past 5 years to do just that. Thank you, Governor, and our elected officials. We are resetting the life of the power of the city from 2015 to 2020, and we have made an audacious pledge to this state. We have set the state of New York, investing in us means that we can take what works across our many campuses and take what works to scale to actually complete more graduates. We already graduate a big number of students, 93% general I said, don't you get tired know the judges were really wanted that to put it into the first introduction, but he was a little afraid of the judge of my stories. Dr. Blair received his PhD from Brandeis University and his undergraduate degree from the London School of Economics and the School of Science. He is a former chair of the Department of Regional Economic and Social Development and currently a member of the Department of Political Science. He has written widely on the politics of occupational health and the environment. But what makes that outcome of the start of the university?
wish to start with that because I think I want to tell you folks to start. Those of you who work in the kitchen and financial aid and in these offices, who clean the bathrooms and provide the food and fix things when they get broken and make sure the service is paid off, take care of that. Thank you. went on to many of these things at State University over 5 years, and she left that place at a more interesting and vibrant campus than I know, and I know people there had just appeared. All of the work I know was driven by profound commitment to public higher education, as did mine. She believed very deeply, I think, that universities should be accessible to those of our students, and the public university system provides that in the United States. She believes deeply, I think, in this public mission. She also recognizes that the university is a place which should nurture creativity and embrace diversity. The former because it's critical to our understanding about development, the second because we have to be a place that gets ideas to flourish. Our commitment to graduate intervention requires understanding the world, means allowing and increasing the diversity of our university. This experience and background helps us understand and think differently about all problems and have the ability to recognize them. Diversity for Dr. Westerberg, as it should be, is not something to be encouraged because it's the right thing or because it's politically correct, but diversity is the capital of creativity, innovation and knowledge, and that is how cultures of universities, right, and civilized society, and to ensure it will be profoundly intellectually dishonest. I know Dr. Westerberg. Christmas is near forever. I'm going to say it's not tableau, it's not required reading, I'm not making those stuff up. You are very, very fortunate to have that as a new president. Most importantly for me, she's a very authentic person. And in a world where human authenticity is a place in common, it's good to know that she's that kind of person. You should also know, as you introduced him earlier, that he has a wonderful family of father two, a kid, Jamie and Chungju. Nobody mentioned Graham Cracker, the dog. Graham Cracker. That's the name. That's what happens when you have your 5-year-old called the name in the dog is just a therapy.
Welcome along. welcomed our extended family. You can see us all sitting up here. We are so grateful for your warm embrace. Now today, I'm asking you to go on a journey with me. I'm asking you to run with me for a while. Now, the start of any race, and you know this, the start of any race is filled with anticipation. It's filled with the pleasure of the day ahead. Forgive me, those of you who aren't runners. Trust me, anticipation. We're also filled with the knowledge that what we are about to accomplish is impossible to plan. The start of any long run is filled with questions. Am I doing this? Will I finish? Am I ready? I want you to imagine the smell of dirt and time and sweat. I want you to imagine that we're climbing a small hill together. Now, at the end of this day, that small hill will feel like a mountain. The journey that we're about to embark on together is longer than anything you have ever done before. Now, for those of you who know me well, you know that I occasionally like to go by foot on just such a journey. And also here I go, for a run longer than a standard 26.2 mile marathon. Now, you're probably wondering, I seem like a nice person, right? Why would any seeming safe person want to do such a thing? I mean, it's long. It can be painful, true. But I submit that it is also a journey full of joy and satisfaction and beauty. It is not a race. And that's a good thing. Now, it's a good thing, trust me. But the peculiar journey of an ultra marathon is about constant motion, relentless movement. You can hear it in that last beat by the breath of right? Taking opportunities to replenish oneself, even while still moving inexorably forward. It is about commitment to the journey. Even though at times the finish seems too distant and your feet hurt, running like this is primarily about persistence. Knowing that even as things feel bad, that everything aches, and everything about it, you'll also feel better. It is about pacing yourself, testing the limits of your ability, your will to finish. So, an ultra marathon is perhaps surprisingly to the few of you who came out of the run, a collective effort, right? To do it together. So, as we fellow runners move throughout the day and even the night, we can be strangers to each other, but we create a small community of hardy runners. We encourage each other through our singular devotion to the task at hand, continuous forward movement. Doing things together builds community, and not only in ultra marathons. Now, an ultra marathon is fundamentally about nature. It is also about urgency. It is a wild patience, as the poet Adrienne Rich called in her poem, Integrity. A wild patience has taken me this far. So even as we move urgently forward, we must be patient. We must pace ourselves. This dynamic between patience and urgency creates tension. It creates anxiety. And as we go on this journey together, we are going to feel it. We're feeling it now. We're going to wonder, is this pace too fast? Will we burn out before the finish? Or are we too slow? Will we fail? These are, without doubt, challenging times for college campuses. As campuses face eroding support for public higher education, fiscal challenges, new sources of competition, we must find ways to rethink ourselves, to use our scarce resources wisely, to continue to make ourselves relevant. Our challenge is to expand opportunity, to help SUNY meet this audacious goal of providing access and success to a larger and more diverse population than ever before. 115,000 graduates each year by 2020. That is a very audacious goal, and we are with you. We must cultivate the creativity that is within every student. Standing at the cusp of our bicentennial year, we have the opportunity to remake ourselves as SUNY Creativity Campus. SUNY Potsdam has evolved and grown and thrived for nearly 200 years, but for too long, SUNY Potsdam has been a hidden gem. We have been keeping this gorgeous campus tucked between the foothills of the Adirondacks and the Canadian border, and yet, where UTF was right. We have been keeping this campus a secret, but we must be secret no longer. No! Now that we celebrate and talk about creativity as a capacity for hard work, imagination, openness to new ideas, the capacity to see fresh connections between chance phenomena, to being open, the unexpected as a means to new breakthroughs and solutions. This is exactly the creativity our students will need to draw as they enter into the world. This is just the creativity that we will need to access as we remake our future in the bicentennial year. Creativity is the energy that starts our life and keeps us moving forward. Now, as a creative campus, we thrive on diversity. As a sociologist, I am never happier, more alive, than when I am surrounded by people who can help me learn and appreciate about cultural diversity. Diversity is brilliant, truly, for its own sake. But a diverse campus is one that leads to much greater creativity as well. And so if we at SUNY Potsdam are to claim the title of SUNY's preeminent creativity campus, and we are well on our way, then we need to ensure that diversity flourishes in our campus community. Now imagine a campus where every single person feels radically, fundamentally at home, no matter their background, their history, their identity, or their beliefs. Imagine a campus that thrives on a diverse array of viewpoints and perspectives. What will it take to get there? Will you help me create it? In an educational setting. We want every student, every employee, every graduate, and every visitor to our campus to feel wildly at home here at SUNY Potsdam. Now, I use the word home advisedly and explicitly. The The note to a poem entails the most basic sense of belonging and familiarity, a fundamental acceptance of our core existence. But home also implies a sense of responsibility. Yay. And it entails, right, doing the kitchen, picking up after each other. It means taking care of each other. Home is where we are pushed to grow and develop. Home is where we become better persons. Home is where we welcome each other, even when we differ, and especially when we argue. What will it be to get there? Will we create this home with me? Thank you. We also claim the creativity of the sciences through the power of STEM education and fuse with us as team. We honor the ingenuity of our faculty and our students in the lab and in the field. The research our faculty and students conduct together, whether a chemistry study funded by the National Institute for Health or an analysis of human ecology on Brooklyn Big Deal. Our professors and students have researched together some amazing things. So we celebrate the creativity of the sciences and the social sciences, our humanities and our liberal arts, from Controller Fest to Archaeology, from Foodline Magazine to seminars on happiness. Faculty and students prove that creativity extends to all disciplines. Dr. Paul Scamalone and Ted Sellenauer, P.T. Boyle shared recently on PBS. A liberal arts education encourages you to find out who you are and what you are. Creating a life is a deeply creative process. So when I think of this kind of creative process, I think of being angry. Being with a theater major originally from Yonkers, he didn't grow up feeling the dirt between his toes, right? Early on in his time here at Boston, he took a backpacking course. Learned outdoor skills. He went on to take a wilderness education minor, complete a 20-day expedition in the Peel Wilderness. He's now a field guide at Open Sky Wilderness Therapy in Colorado. Now, Dean exemplifies creativity in action. And were it not for his hard learning experience, he would never have been able to become the skilled outdoors educator that he is today. Experiences like these are critical to help our students discover their passion, learn real life skills, and develop the tools they need to succeed in our fast-changing world. And so I am proud to say that SUNY Hopkins is becoming a leader within SUNY for applied learning, supported by the generous gift of Joy and Dick Joy. Our Center for Applied Learning will enable us to ensure that every SUNY Hopkins student will have the opportunity to apply what they are learning in a real world experience, whether an internship, a study abroad opportunity, research with a faculty member, or a service learning experience, and they'll reflect on that experience. Now, imagine a campus where every student has the ability to apply what they are learning outside the classroom. Imagine a campus that is richly diverse, where every student, every person is valued, and where the whole is significantly greater than its parts. Imagine what SUNY Hopkins can become in our next 200 years. What does it take? Will you help me make it? And we have done so remarkably. We have built a spectacular creative community of teachers, scholars, students, artists. And as we look forward, as we embrace our creative future, as we seek to create and nurture our diverse community, we need every bit of that
It takes a whole village to raise our children. It takes a whole village to raise one child. We all, everyone, must share the burden. We all, everyone, must share the joy.
exceptional is Mark's play, Commemorative Peace, especially written to honor